Good morning. Our scripture reading this morning is taken from Acts chapter 9, verses 1 to 6, and this can be found on page 127 in the New Testament portion of your Pew Bible. Reading from Acts chapter 9, beginning at verse 1, hear what the Spirit says to the church. Meanwhile, Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues at Damascus, so if he found any who belonged to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Now as he was going along and approaching Damascus, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" He asked, "Who are you, Lord?" The reply came, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But get up and enter the city, and you will be told what you are to do." This is the word of the Lord.
How many church people does it take to change a light bulb? What? Change? What's wrong with the one we have? The church can be pretty resistant to change, as we know. Wars have actually been fought over it. Last weekend at our stewardship conference that we were at in Ontario, our team heard at one point from one participant that the C word, the change word, was just too violent a word to use in the church anymore. And that we needed to change it to something more like growing forward. Come on, right? Okay, it's true, we have been living in a torrent of change. Yeah, that's why there's so much anxiety about this word, change, because really, it's been a torrent. And you have lived in probably the greatest movement of change that the world has ever seen. So if it sometimes makes you feel anxious, it's perfectly normal because of what we're living in the midst of. Yet, let's also remember, like, Who of us would want to go back to the day when women couldn't vote, when men really were not much in the way of nurturers of children, or even in the days when Canada did not have Medicare for everyone? You know, would we want to go back to that? So not all change is bad, right? Or the days before running water and electricity in our homes. Change is not a bad word here in the church. And that's why I thought this morning that we should do a little bit of rehabilitation of that word, because the gospel of Jesus Christ is about change. Exactly. It's at its very core. That's what we celebrate, the possibility of real, authentic change. So I would say that as water is to ducks, so transformational change is to the church. In your vows of baptism, profession of faith, you actually promised to keep changing for the rest of your life. Yeah, you did. Turning from the deeply ingrained ways of sin and turning to the life-giving way of Jesus Christ and his kingdom. We live out our baptism every day by inviting the Spirit to change us as we keep dying to the old life of sin. And part of that is the need to control, manage, and fix, and rising to this new life of freedom when we surrender our lives to the love and will of Christ, so that the Spirit works in and through us to do far more than we could ever do ourselves. For us, the possibility of change, authentic, real change, is emblematic of hope. The possibility of real change, think in our own lives, in our own community of faith, in our world, with all of its hurt, pain, and divisions. The possibility of change is hope. It's at the center of who we are. So in this great 50 days of Easter, we are in the midst of a sermon series called Life Elevated. And you'll see on the cover of the worship guide today, our window. Because as I was sitting there one day, I think it might have actually been on Holy Thursday in worship. We were planning this worship series then, and I looked up and I thought, this window talks about life elevated. It talks about the life of the cross, resurrection life of Christ pouring down into our world and raising us up to a whole new level of humanity, grace, and love in the world. So this sermon series, Life Elevated, is it's a tour of the Acts of the Apostles. And this book itself really is a tour of transformational change in human lives as the power of the resurrection descends and infiltrates individuals and a whole community of people. It's like the power of resurrection is now let loose in this community of faith and for the good of the world. And so you can think of some of those images from the book of Acts. You know them. Like on Pentecost, a mob of doubting scoffers is transformed into, the baptized, as 3,000 people are baptized and become part of the church that day. Or think of a murderous Saul who is transformed into Paul, the apostle to the Gentiles. Or think of a foreign Ethiopian eunuch who is seen as someone on the very fringes of the known world is transmuted to become part of the baptized of this newly emerging Christian community. The God who made the world out of chaos keeps creating and keeps pulling life out of death and reminding us that real change is very possible. So Saul's encounter with the risen Christ on the road to Damascus is probably one of the best stories that we know from the book of Acts. It is the recollection of this story is actually found three different places in this book. So it reminds us that this story is actually of central importance to the book itself. When it's retold three times, it's like, pay attention to this story, because it tells us something about who God is and what God wants for us as the people of God. And what we see in Saul's life is once this divine encounter happens, that his life is totally turned upside down. This is a 180 change of direction for him. We only get to meet him in the chapter before this in the book of Acts. And what we know first is that he's there when Stephen is so violently stoned because he is speaking the Christian gospel. And Saul is kind of almost enjoying this. And then we hear how he is part of this ravaging of the early church, this hauling people out of their homes, and resulting in some of them being murdered because they're Christians. You could say, if you want a parallel, that what Adolf Hitler was to the Jews, Saul was to these early Christians in this fledgling Christian community at this time. So then one day, now what we read about Saul is how powerful he was. He is in charge, and he is going to stamp out this sectarian movement of people of the way, as it was called. And so there he is walking down to Damascus. He's got more ravaging that he's planning to do there, and he is struck down by this power that comes from the risen Christ. There's a flash of light that envelops him. He falls to the road. And it's the overwhelming power of the Holy Spirit that comes upon him. And I mean, some of you can probably say, I remember that moment. You know, when somehow the power of God is revealed in our midst, whether it's a flash of light or whether it's just this incredible sense that we have inside of us, God is present. Who are you? Paul asks. And recognizing this powerful, transcendent God, Paul is swept into this power that is beyond human control. I am Jesus, the one you are hunting down, and I want you to go enter the city, and you get this line, you will be told what to do next. Nobody told him what to do before this, right? He was in charge. He was going to fix this. He had it. And he goes from this place of power that he has knocked right down to having to get up, and he is blind. And the passage tells us he had to be led by the hand back to the city. This is a major, major change. And it's telling us how transformation happens as well. You know, that transformation, the way to transformation is not this way towards success. The way of transformation is this way towards weakness, towards humility, towards giving over our lives to Christ and his way. And so this powerhouse of persecution is changed and becomes Paul, the apostle to the Gentiles. Now, the joy of being called as a disciple of Christ is that there is always the possibility of change. So no matter how we get discouraged with our own selves, like, there, I did it again. I said I was never doing that again, and there it is. We can get discouraged because on our own, We cannot bring the kind of change that we long for in ourselves or in our world. But there's a power that is actually able to accomplish that in us if we are willing to surrender and follow this descending way and be overpowered by the risen Christ himself. Ordinary people can receive power for extraordinary change. So listen now. We have one witness in our midst who has known this in his own life and also in the life of St. Andrew's Church. And I'm going to invite one of our elders, David Platt, to come and illustrate for you this kind of transformational change that God is able to accomplish. Welcome, David.
My road to Damascus experience was perhaps not as quite as dramatic as Paul's, but it happened in 1995. Joanne and I were at a spiritual retreat in Saskatoon, and it was taking place in a Roman Catholic high school. And on the Saturday night after we had all settled down, I went to the chapel. And it was very quiet and quite late at night. And I felt very open and vulnerable and was just receiving a lot of love from the people that were leading the retreat. And because it was a Catholic high school, and in the chapel was a cross with Jesus on it. And I had an experience there that Jesus spoke to me, and he said, David, you don't need to be frightened anymore. And there's nothing to worry about. I'm dying. I'm going to live again. And the Holy Spirit will be with you. And I just want you to relax and enjoy your life and love people. And you don't have to worry anymore. Now, my life has not been fear-free for the last 25 years, I can assure you. But it's given me a great confidence that no matter what happens, no matter the ebb and flow of real estate markets or the stock market or the economy or whatever, everything's going to be okay in Jesus Christ. We've just come back from Ontario. We had a wonderful weekend with various Presbyterian congregations throughout the country. And actually, how many Presbyterians does it take to change a light bulb? My mother donated that light bulb 30 years ago. We don't need to change it. So that's just a derivative of the change. But I know, and I can tell you in confidence, that the Presbyterian Church in Canada is committed to a path of change and looking forward and transformation. And it was wonderful to hook up with colleagues from Charlottetown and Nova Scotia down to Vancouver Island to hear what's happening in our community, our Presbyterian community. For many years now, the mainline churches have actually been offering answers to questions that people are not asking. What are people asking these days? Where can I find community? Where can I find family? Where can I find my people? And I came to Canada all alone 30-odd years ago and looking for family and community. And Calgary welcomed me, very egalitarian society, very welcoming, non-judgmental. And I settled into life in Calgary. But people are asking deeper, where can I find community and support? And this I'll use, and Reverend Frank has warned me that no analogies are perfect, so at the risk of being imperfect, I'll use the Starbucks analogy. Starbucks did not invent coffee. They did not even invent the coffee shop, and their coffee actually sometimes isn't very good. But the genius of Starbucks is community. It's a shallow community, nonetheless. But what Starbucks says is, come as you are. Come on in. Actually, we don't even care if you buy anything. Bring your laptop, sit at the desk, enjoy yourself, and feel part of a community. Just an analogy. But that's what people are looking for in a church, is community and family and that sense of coming home. Where can I find compassion? Where can I find people who will not judge me, who will not criticize me, who will love me and support me, no matter what state my life is in. People are flocking to 12-step programs, Al-Anon, Adult Children of Alcoholics, Alcoholics Anonymous. So a bleary-eyed, red-eyed, disheveled, rather dirty, unkempt person stumbles into their first AA meeting, knowing that their life is a wreck. And we say, come on in. Welcome. We are glad you're here. You are so important. And that person gets surrounded by love and compassion and no judgment and introduced through the 12 steps, step three actually, to the loving grace and the compassion of God. The 12 steps comes out of the Christian tradition. It's rooted in the Oxford group and the Christian tradition. But people will flock to compassion. People will flock to compassion. Where can I find hope? People are looking for hope. Witness the billions of dollars that people spend, another imperfect analogy, on lottery tickets, in the vain hope that their life will change. It's a short-term hope. It may only last for 20 minutes or half an hour or a day. But at the end of the day, it is a vain hope because the odds are stacked against it, against the purchaser of the ticket. When Josh, our son, announced that he was transgender 4 years ago, we found all three of these components at St. Andrew's. We found community, we found compassion, and we found hope. It was a seismic shift. We had been married for 20 years. We had raised a kid, and then this. The grace and the compassion and the love we'd received at St. Andrew's gave us the grace to say to our kid, we love you, no matter what, and we will do whatever it takes to support you through this journey. That is the unrelenting compassion that Jesus gives us. And Josh is doing well. Our journey's far from over. We've had tough times. But Jesus has been in the boat with us every step of the way. And he will not let us flounder. And Jesus has been calling me over the last 3 years very quietly and tenderly and softly. And I spent the last 3 years, what do you want me to do? Where do I go? Now I'm retired. What am I supposed to do? But very quietly, Jesus has been calling me into a deeper relationship and with him. I'll use another analogy, imperfect though it is. In poker, I don't know much about the game, I don't play it, but in poker, the winning hand is four aces. It's unbeatable. Actually, Jared and I had a bit of a debate about this in between the sermons. He thought it might be a royal flush, but I think we're agreed that it's four aces. When a poker player has four aces, they go all in. They take all their chips, they take everything that they've got, and they go all in because they know that they have the winning hand. We have that in our faith. We have the good news of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. We have the four Gospels, we have the book of Acts, and we have the rest of the Bible. That's what people are looking for. Why wouldn't we go all in? And that's what I believe Jesus is calling us to do, into the deeper water. Community, compassion, and hope. I think you're going to, and I pray that you're going to hear these words a lot as we move forward in our future. Like many enterprises in Calgary and Alberta, we are facing a few headwinds. Excuse me. Could we put the slide up of the stewardship, please? We are facing some headwinds. Our church is in great shape. We are a strong community. We are just facing a few financial headwinds. I'm waiting on that slide. Is it there? Pardon? The $100 one? Good. Sorry, I just didn't see the different backdrop. I'm not perfect. We put this slide together just to reassure everyone in the congregation that we're in good shape. When you invest $100 at St. Andrew's, 39% of it goes to meaningful and vibrant worship. $11 supports the vulnerable in our community. $8 encourages and equips our children. $15 shares the gospel with others throughout our community and in the world. $7 equips our youth, and $20 pays for G&A expenses. This church is in a strong financial position, and this building and the maintenance and the operation of the church is supported by that $20. And as we move forward, we are free as a congregation to tweak these numbers any way that Jesus calls us. But we wanted to give you, I wanted to try and prepare something that's fairly easy and a snapshot of what our resources are being used for at this moment. This church is in good shape. We are experiencing some financial headwinds, and I want to invite and encourage everyone to have a look to see what we can do to refuel, reinvigorate, and get over this temporary situation. What Joanne and I have decided to do, we were fortunate, we're hoping to get a nice tax refund. So we've tithed 10% of that, and we've increased our PAR, and we're volunteering to lead Alpha in the fall. Over the years, I've experienced many discouragements, and I believe that Jesus takes our hurts and our weaknesses and our pain and turns them into strengths. I have experienced many, many times of discouragement in my life. From 2 years onward, when I developed asthma and felt that there was no hope and didn't know if there was going to be another breath there when I exhaled. Jesus wants to take our greatest hurts, our greatest sorrows, and turn them into our greatest strengths. What specific immediate action can our family take, not recklessness, but thoughtful discernment, to contribute to our community? We have a glorious past, and we honor the saints that had the vision to take St. Andrew's from Inglewood to Heritage Drive. It was the building, build it, and they will come era in the 1950s and 60s. These days are gone, and we are powerless over the change. But as they say in the first steps of the AA program, we admitted we were powerless, but that does not mean hopeless. That does not mean hopeless. We are powerless over change, but we are far from hopeless. We have a few shadows in the church that creep in when any community gets together. Judgmentalism, criticism, intolerance. And what I feel is the big one, the grandfather, the granddaddy of them all, perfectionism. We are not perfect. We are a group of human beings, flawed but loved in the eyes of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ says, come as you are. The song says, come as you are. We come as we are, and we put ourselves into Jesus' hands, and Jesus will transform us. There are exciting times coming in the near future. Tim would not have accepted this call if this congregation was not committed to change. This is what we've shared on our journey and our time together over the weekend. He has come to help us, to shepherd us, and Jared and Christian as well, to shepherd us through change. We're going to be revisioning from the grassroots. Everybody in the congregation is going to be involved in this process. The days of top-down authoritarianism are gone because they destroy community. We want to hear people's experiences. Hope, hearing other people's experiences. Jesus wants us to find our spiritual gifts. He wants to develop a deep, personal, intimate relationship with every one of us. St. Andrew's will support us and love us and encourage us. And in that process, we will experience true community, real compassion, and eternal and unshakable hope. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.